Good morning and welcome to the second day of the conference. Today, our first speaker is Hannes Gissurarson. He's a professor of political science at the University of Iceland and a frequent commentator on current affairs in the Icelandic media. He is best known as a controversial spokesman for free market policies and for neoliberalism or classic liberalism. Please welcome Hannes Gissurarson.
Well, I am not entirely sure that I would be very controversial in this room. I think I am more controversial amongst the socialists in Iceland. But I wanted to discuss the personalities and ideas of three major liberal thinkers. I think there is no disagreement that Friedrich Hayek, Karl Popper, and Milton Friedman are those classical liberal libertarian thinkers that enjoy the most admiration, not only within libertarian circles, but also elsewhere. Both of them got the Nobel Prize, Hayek and Friedman, and Popper is recognized as one of the most distinguished philosophers of the 20th century. I was actually in Lima in Peru 2 weeks ago, and there Mario Vargas Llosa, the Nobel laureate in literature from Peru, he said that when he read Popper, it was like a new world opened up to him. He realized that he had been a classical liberal all along, and Popper was able to articulate it much better than he had been able to do himself. And I first encountered The Road to Serfdom by Hayek in 1978 or 9, and I was completely taken in by the book, The Road to Serfdom. I found it an extremely interesting and enlightening book, and it really made me into more of a radical libertarian than I had been before. And with a few friends of mine in Iceland, we founded the Libertarian Alliance, and we chose to do it on Hayek's 80th birthday, on the 8th of May, 1979, and I wrote a letter to Hayek and told him that we young people in Iceland had founded this alliance on his birthday. He was very pleased with this and responded in a nice letter and offered to come to Iceland and give lectures, and we were of course delighted to accept that. And I translated The Road to Serfdom into Icelandic before he came to Iceland. And then he came and I took him to dinner the first night, and with me was the chairman of the Young Independents in Iceland. The Independence Party is the biggest party. It's a liberal conservative party in Iceland. And he accompanied me, or we were three of us. We went to a seafood restaurant and we had a very nice conversation with Hayek. He liked the Icelandic seafood, and he told us that his favorite red wine was Burgundy, that he preferred it to all other wines. And we had a discussion about many things with Hayek during this first evening that he was with us in Iceland. He told us a lot about Keynes. He admired the genius of Keynes. He said he was a man of many talents, and he recalled how he had been sitting with him in a dinner party at Cambridge University, and Keynes could effortlessly switch from discussing Elizabethan literature to old furniture and to finance, etc. But one story that Hayek told us is an interesting one, because it really does have a deep message. Hayek told us that during his last dinner conversation with Keynes, Hayek said, "Are you not concerned that some of your disciples, like Joan Robinson and Lord Kahn," he was not Lord then, "they are using your ideas to promote inflation. They are basically doing things that will lead to inflation." And Keynes said, "Well, that's not really a problem. They are fools. What will you see? I wrote the general theory in 1936 because unemployment was the gravest problem. If inflation becomes a grave problem, then I will turn public opinion around like this." And he moved his hand like this. The problem was, 6 weeks later, he was dead. And the morale of this story is, we cannot put our trust in great men, because when we need them, they will sometimes not be around. We have to put our trust in institutions, in principles, in foreseeable, predictable, general rules. And this is really one of the contrasts between libertarianism or classical liberalism on the one hand and socialism on the other hand, that we believe in rules and principles and they believe in discretionary power. So I think that even if this is an anecdote, it tells us a lot about the contrast between liberalism and socialism. Then he gave a paper called The Medal of the Middle in Iceland on the 5th of April 1918. And basically his argument there, which is very relevant now when everybody is discussing Thomas Piketty's ideas or demands for global redistribution of income, his argument was, Hayek's in his paper, that John Stuart Mill made a fundamental error in his economics when he made a distinction between laws of production and laws of distribution. The reason being that when goods come into this world, being produced into this world, they are also distributed in the process. So that what you have to do then is to redistribute them, take them from the people who produce them and put them elsewhere. So there is no difference between the process of production and the process of distribution, Hayek said. And for him, of course, income distribution was really information provided to us about how we should really utilize our abilities. If we utilize them in the correct way, our income will rise. If we do it in an inefficient way, our income will be reduced. Hayek said to us, and he repeated many times, he said, I think that the socialists are well-meaning people, but they are just wrong about certain fundamentals of life, such as that you can make a distinction between production and distribution of income. And then we took Hayek to the rather some of the harsh environments of Iceland. Here Geir Horte and I, we are with him at Þingvellir, our old parliamentary site. As some of you may know, we established in Iceland a parliament in 930, and we had a very interesting Commonwealth from 930 to 1262, where the enforcement of rules were in the hands of individuals. There was no real executive power in Iceland at that time, and David Friedman and others, they have written interesting articles about how we coped with the absence of a state and how we could really run a rather flourishing community there for 300 years. But Iceland doesn't really have a very very welcome climate, as you can see from this this photograph here, interesting as the country is. And then I showed to Hayek what I had written about him in Iceland, because I had had a lot of debates with the socialists about his ideas. And what he did, having looked at all this, was to invite me to the Montpellier Society, which he had founded in 1947 with Milton Friedman and Karl Popper and many other people, to go to meetings there. And so I met Hayek occasionally during the next few years, here in Berlin, for example, in 1982, when the then mayor of Berlin, Richard von Weizsäcker, invited us to a very nice party at Charlottenburg, and then we met with Jacques Chirac in Paris, and Chirac proclaimed to be a great admirer of Hayek. I'm not entirely sure that that was correct. I think it was more polite talk than anything else. And then I met him in Cambridge in 1984. And then he visited me and other friends of mine in Oxford. What happened was that I started working on a doctoral dissertation in Oxford in 1981, and the dissertation was about Hayek. And there was another friend of mine there, the one in the middle, Chandran Kukatas. He also was writing a dissertation on Hayek. His dissertation was about Hayek's theory of justice compared to Rawls' theory of justice, but my dissertation was about how Hayek successfully combined conservative insights and classical liberal principles in a coherent whole, which we could call conservative liberalism. That was my doctoral dissertation. And we formed at Oxford a Hayek Society and invited people there. Hayek, of course, was also delighted about this and came to visit us and discuss his ideas with us. Then I could talk him into accepting an invitation of ours to go to the Ritz Hotel in London in 1985 for a dinner. Well, what happened was that he accepted our invitation to go to dinner. And I contacted a friend of mine in the US, Leonard Licio, Some of you may have heard of him. He recently passed away. He was a wonderful man, a leader of the libertarian movement. Everybody knows him. That is sort of in their 30s and 40s. And I told Lizzie, I can't really take Professor von Hayek to a Hamburg joint or something, you know. And they gave me a grant from the Hayek Fund that Leonard Lizzie administered. So I was able to take him to the Ritz Hotel. So the five of us who were very interested in Hayek's ideas at Oxford, we spent an evening with him, and it was quite an evening where Hayek did a lot of talk with us. He was extremely pleased with being with us. He was in a very good mood. He told us, for example, that he had met four presidents. Calvin Coolidge, believe it or not, in 1923. Then Hayek was a Rockefeller fellow in the US, a very young man. He was 24 years old. And the American Economic Association had a meeting in Washington, D.C. And it was so small at that time that Calvin Coolidge could have a reception in the White House for the whole of the American Economic Association. And then he met Hoover and Kennedy and Reagan. And he said that for him, the contrast between Kennedy and Reagan was that Kennedy was well prepared, but he hadn't read anything that Hayek had written, whereas Reagan was unpretentious and said, well, Professor Hayek, I've read one of your books, The Road to Serfdom, and that really made an impact on me. So he was a much more sincere man, the actor. He also told us how Mrs. Thatcher had disarmed him when he came to Downing Street. The fact of the matter was that Mrs. Thatcher was a disciple of Hayek, and she actually took the Constitution of Liberty to a meeting of civil servants, slammed it down on the table and said, "Here is what we believe in," she said to the audience. And when she heard, very soon after she took power, on the 5th of May 1979, that Hayek was in London, he lived in Freiburg at that time, but occasionally came to London, she invited him to 10 Downing Street. And he came there and she greeted him at the door and she said to him, "Professor Hayek, I know precisely what you are going to say. You are going to say that they haven't done enough. And you are absolutely right." And Hayek told us that by this, she totally disarmed him. He couldn't really criticize her after that. Not that he really needed to, because he was a great admirer of Mrs. Thatcher, but this was a clever way of disarming him that she employed then. And then Hayek was in such good mood that when the musicians there came with their instruments and asked us whether we liked any song to be played, we whispered to him or them, "The City of My Dreams," which is a song about Vienna composed early in the 20th century before the fall of the Habsburg Empire, and he began to sing along with the musicians. He was in such good mood, and this was he was 86 years old at that time. He also made a lot of observations at the dinner. He said, for example, he was a thoughtful man and we were just having small talk for a while, and then he suddenly said, without being prompted, "The great opposite of liberty is liberation." And then he explained it. He said that if we liberate ourselves from the rules and traditions and practices and conventions that we have inherited, then we basically will lose liberty. So that liberation is the opposite of liberty. And I think this is a very deep and profound observation. It may be contested by some libertarians, but it is quite an interesting one. And he gave this little talk about this. At the end of the dinner, he gave a little speech, and he told us this: "I am of course very happy and pleased that you, young scholars starting your careers, writing doctoral dissertations at Oxford University about my theories, discussing them and taking an interest in them, that you are here with me. And this has been a very, very pleasant evening. But I have to ask you to promise me one thing. I have observed that the Marxists are much worse than Marx, and that the Keynesians are much worse than Keynes, so you have to promise me not to become Hayekians. You have to maintain your critical faculties. You have to be independent. And this was a remarkable observation of his, in my opinion. And I still remember this because he said it at the same time as he was obviously very pleased with us discussing and criticizing his theories. Hayek was a very good friend of Karl Popper, who was by many regarded as one of the greatest philosophers of the 20th century. And Popper was a co-founder, as I said earlier, of the Mont Pelerin Society. And I was fortunate enough to spend that. I didn't know Popper personally well, as I did Hayek and Friedman. He never came to Iceland. I never spent much time with him. But he actually gave me a day of his life. I went to Penn in Buckinghamshire, where he lived, and had a day with him discussing his theories and his ideas. And as you may know, he wrote The Open Society and Its Enemies, and there he said that the basic enemies of the Open Society were Plato and Aristotle and Hegel and Marx. But the judgment of most scholars who have gone into it is that Popper was too critical to Hegel. And I said to him, well, Professor Popper, do you really think that Hegel is responsible for the totalitarian excesses of Hitler and Stalin in the 20th century? And he gave a rather strange answer. He said, well, not totally, but perhaps 15%. And where he got the 15% beats me. And he was very pleasant and friendly. Some people had told me that he was not. When he was a professor at the London School of Economics, he was very harsh. He took people down at seminars and so on. So people even nicknamed his book The Open Society by one of its enemies, because he was not reputed as taking criticism very easily. But to me, he was perfectly gentlemanly and pleasant, and even if I voiced all those criticisms, like about Hegel, he just was very nice and gentle. He spoke very highly of Hayek. He said, I was languishing away in New Zealand. People were killing me with administrative duties there and so on. I couldn't really do what I was interested in doing. And Hayek was instrumental in getting me a professorship at the London School of Economics. So he really saved my life and enabled me to write books and explore my thoughts and so on. So he was very, very well disposed to Hayek. And his conception of liberalism, classical liberalism, was, as he told me and as he has also written about this, that liberalism is an endless struggle against identifiable problems, against evils. And he spoke a lot to me about the tension in liberalism, which is, to him, that in order to protect liberty and to struggle against the problems, we have to accept power. But power has a law of its own, it can grow, it will be abused. So there is a tension in liberalism where we have this necessary but dangerous instrument, which power is. It's just like fire. Fire is necessary, but it can also burn up whole houses. That was basically his message about the problem, the tension in liberalism. He discussed many other things. I thought that at the same time as he had been harsh about Hegel, he had been far too soft on Marx. If you read The Open Society and Its Enemies, he really does dismiss Hegel as not a serious thinker, which I think is not correct. But he is very respectful to Marx. So I asked him, why are you so soft on Marx in your book, The Open Society? And then he did something as surprising as when he answered me about Hegel. He stood up, went to his library, took out two books by Elizabeth Gaskell, a novelist from the 19th century, Mary Barton on North and South, and said, well, you know, I read those books by Elizabeth Gaskell about the terrible conditions of the working class in England in early 19th century. And Marx was rebelling against this. Well, I must say that this is not a very strong argument. Two novels by Elizabeth Barton, which necessarily will give excessive attention to problems instead of solutions. So I was under-impressed by this answer of his Popper's. He also said that he had taken a particular interest in Iceland, and he said, I was born and raised in the Habsburg Empire. And the Habsburg Empire was a country or a state or many nations. And I don't believe really that the national state is relevant or is really a relevant concept. We will actually hear something else, I'm sure, from Daniel Hannan. It will be very interesting to hear what he will say about this tonight. But that's what Popper said. The idea of a national state is really incoherent. There are no national states except perhaps Iceland. Because in Iceland, the nation and the country completely coincide, because we settled the country 1100 years ago, and there has been no immigration or emigration. There are no minorities there. We are divided from the rest of the world by the North Atlantic, and as you could see from the rain that Hayek endured, the climate is rather harsh. So he said this is the only nation state that I can think of, and actually it is not a full national state because it cannot defend itself. The United States undertakes its defense, as was correct at the time. And then he also told me that he had attended seminars about Iceland in Vienna when he was a young man, because the Icelanders, as you know, discovered America, although, as Oscar Wilde said, they had a good sense to lose it again. They discovered it in the year 1000. And it came out in my discussions with Popper that he was a great admirer both of Winston Churchill and Margaret Thatcher. He said that he had usually in the past voted for Labour, but he had voted for the Conservatives while Mrs. Thatcher was the leader of the Conservative Party. And then the third person that I got to know and discuss ideas with was Milton Friedman. Hayek has, as I told you, invited me to the Montpellier Society meetings. The first one was in 1980. And there I met Milton Friedman, and I said to him at the ball where we had a small chat or a short chat, well, Professor Friedman, you know that I'm busy defending you in Iceland. And Friedman said, characteristically, don't defend me. Defend our ideas. I still remember that. And he told me that he was on his way to China. He was going there at the invitation of the Chinese government. And I believe that his visit to China in 1980 had a great impact, because he told the Chinese government, look to Hong Kong. Why doesn't China do something like Hong Kong? Why doesn't China liberalize? And I believe that they listened to him. Of course, this was not the only influence on them, but I believe that his visit to China was quite successful. Then I translated Capitalism and Freedom into Icelandic and met Friedman in West Berlin in 1982, and he decided to visit us in Iceland in 1984. And first he gave a press conference, and an Icelandic reporter asked him, Professor Friedman, do you have a solution for all our problems in just one word? Friedman said, yes. The reporter said, what word is that? Freedom. That was quite effective at the press conference. And he gave a lecture, a public lecture on the 1st of September 1984, about the tyranny of the status quo. And he really was in full action in Iceland. There was a television debate between him and three Icelandic socialists, and it's all on YouTube. Those of you who haven't watched it should really do it. It only takes, you have to Google just YouTube, Friedman, Iceland, and then it will come up. And socialists, they complained about the public lecture he gave, because we charged for it. And one of them said, Professor Friedman, it has been very interesting to speak to you now, but I cannot afford to go to your lecture tomorrow, because there's a charge. It was actually $40, but there's a charge there, and I cannot afford it. And I don't think this is what I mean by freedom, that I am not able to go to a meeting like this. Friedman said, wait a minute. I don't agree with your idea of freedom. You must have had lecturers before. They must have cost something. Their airfare, the advertisements for the meetings, the rent for the meeting halls, and so on. Who paid for that? I think that those that go to such lectures should pay for the lectures, not the others that do not go to the lectures. And what you are basically demanding is, by demanding so-called free lectures, is that those who do not go to the lectures and have no interest in the lectures, they contribute to them instead of only those who go there. So he basically, he gave an extremely cogent answer that has been accepted by everybody. And this is of course only a variant of his old message: there is no such thing as a free lecture. Then the Icelandic Chamber of Commerce, the business community in Iceland, invited Friedman to a dinner party, and the first question by the businessman was, Professor Friedman, who or which is the greatest threat to liberty? Friedman answered, look into a mirror. The businessmen are always trying to limit competition. They are not really the supporters of capitalism. I support capitalism because capitalism is good for the consumers, for the workers, for the poor who can produce themselves out of poverty. But you, the business community, you are always trying to fight real capitalism by cronyism, by monopolies, and by special favors extended to you by government. So if you want to see the enemy of freedom, look into a mirror. The businessman was slightly taken aback by this first answer, but then discussion became in a way softer to them, and they liked a lot of what Friedman said. Then there was a lunch that the Minister of Trade gave in Iceland, and I stood by Professor Friedman, and the governor of the Central Bank came. And I turned to Friedman and said, Professor Friedman, here is a man who would become unemployed if your theories would be implemented in Iceland, the governor of the Central Bank. And Friedman said, no, he wouldn't become unemployed. He would only have to transfer to a more profitable job. And this is of course also a deep insight that capitalism is a way of transferring us, of guiding us without force to more profitable employments all the time. And here you can see the two Friedmans, Milton and Rose, with the Minister of Trade just before the lunch, but after he had met the governor of the Central Bank. Then I was fortunate enough, when I was a visiting scholar at Stanford University, to meet very often with Friedman and Rose, Milton and Rose Friedman, in their very nice house in San Francisco. And I also spent some time with them at their summer house in Summer Ranch, which is 2 hours north of San Francisco. And I had a lot of discussions there with Friedman. I said one evening when we were having white wine and the fire was in the fireplace and it was night and the Pacific Ocean was brimming outside the window, I said, Professor Friedman, I have been asked to give a lecture about the moral philosophy of liberalism in Italy in a few months. What is, in your opinion, the core of liberalism? What is really the point, just in one sentence? And he said it was tolerance. It was our consciousness that we might be wrong. And he said, surprising as it may be, I would quote Cromwell about it, because Cromwell has a very famous passage where he speaks to the parliament about, you know, remember that you may be wrong. This was basically his answer to what is the core value of liberalism. It is humility. It is the notion that we all make fallacies or errors, and the only way of correcting them are through a process of trial and error and freedom. When I was staying with him, I wanted to go to bed, and I liked to take a book with me to bed, and he lent me a book by Barbara Brandon about Ayn Rand. And he said one complimentary thing and one uncomplimentary thing about Ayn Rand. He obviously had found her interesting. The complimentary thing was, he said, I believe that Ayn Rand has made more people libertarians than either Hayek or I. She has been extremely effective in making people libertarians. And then he shrugged his shoulders and laughed a little and said, but boy, was he personally intolerant. And then he lent me the book and I read the book. I remember vividly one little incident that they were discussing, Rose and he. They were writing their memoirs and they said, what are we going to write about Arthur Burns, the governor of the Fed? Because Arthur Burns, when he was the governor during Nixon's years, Nixon imposed freezing wages and prices. And Arthur Burns supported this. But Arthur Burns knew that it was wrong and counter-effective. He did something that went against his knowledge and his convictions. And they were absolutely astonished at this because they had looked up to Arthur Burns. He had been their mentor. He had taught them at Rutgers University and helped them in their intellectual career. So they were wondering how they were going to tackle this in their memoirs, when people go against their conviction, because that's something that Milton Friedman never did. He never spoke against his own conviction. He sometimes qualified his statements. He wasn't going out to try to be outrageous, but he was extremely courageous man, a man of convictions. Then I met him many times at the Montpellier Society meetings, and he said a lot of interesting things. For example, there was a Swedish economist who came to him and said, you know, Professor Friedman, in Sweden we don't know any poverty. Swedes are not poor. And Friedman said, that's interesting. The Swedes in America aren't poor either. And it's a very interesting research that has been done on this. If you look at, and the Institute of Economic Affairs in London has published it, if you look at Swedes in Sweden, they had in the year of reference about 40, let us say, thousand dollars per capita. Then the Swedes in the United States, they had 20,000 more. They had almost 60,000 US dollars per capita in income, because the census makes a distinction, so you can actually compare the income of Swedes in Sweden and the income of Swedes in the US. So there were no poor Swedes in the US either. And it's very interesting also to compare the sort of northern states like Manitoba and North Dakota with the northern countries, and they actually have higher GDP and lower social problems on most criteria. Then he also told us, and everybody has heard this, when the Chinese Minister of Planning asked him, who is my colleague in the US that I can meet? Go to the stock market, that's your colleague in the US, he said. And I met Friedman as well in Vancouver in 1999 and in Washington in 2002, and that was the latest meeting. Here he is with Sam Husbands, whom some of you may know. He was a libertarian stockbroker and very instrumental in many of the institutes, free market institutes in the US. And I last met Friedman at a barbecue at Ed Crane's house in Washington, D.C. In 2002. He had just been to the to the younger Bush to receive a medal, and he was discussing the two presidents. He actually thought that the younger Bush was more of a libertarian than the older one. I know that that's something which would be controversial to some of you, but he said the younger Bush is much more interested in cutting taxes than the old one. I remember when I was an advisor to President Reagan that George Bush was usually in the audience or usually at the meetings, but he never said anything. He appeared to me to be a country club Republican with Denny convictions. The young one is really sold on tax cuts. That's what he said. And he was in very good mood. He was in good health, but soon after he passed away. I would like then finally to make a short comparison between these three thinkers. They were all, in my opinion, remarkable, striking, strong personalities, very noble persons. Of the three of them, I think Hayek was the most profound thinker. His insight that dispersed knowledge requires dispersed power and that we can only overcome individual ignorance by the free market signal system and by traditions and convention. So it's a very deep and profound insight that should really be one of the crucial pillars of social science. So he is the deepest of the three of them. Popper, however, has a different insight. His idea of negative utilitarianism is quite an interesting one. He says, it's not really controversial what is evil in the world. It is diseases, it's poverty, it's war, and so on. So let us concentrate on reducing evil, instead of minimizing evil, instead of maximizing happiness. Because there are so many ideas about what happiness is. We can never reach an agreement about happiness, but we can reach an agreement about evils. So we should really fight evils instead of trying to create happiness. This is what Popper called negative utilitarianism. And of the three, without comparison, Friedman was the sharpest one in both in debate and in scholarly research. He was extremely clear. I told you a lot of his stories, his comments, his replies, both on the Icelandic television and in the Icelandic dinner parties. And he was quick as lightning. He was quite small by stature, but he really was an intellectual giant. But the final words would be that my conclusion is that we should, even if we want to recall those three remarkable personalities, we must never give in to any cult of personality, and we should heed the advice of Hayek. We should not become Hayekians, neither should we become Popperians or Friedmanites. We should remain libertarians, and we should be united in our love of liberty. So, are there questions or?
Okay, for the lack of time, we're going to take just a few questions from the audience. So, I see one over there.
Hello, my name is Christopher. I'm from Sweden. Hello, everybody. Thank you very much for that very amusing and insightful session. I would like to ask you two questions, if you please. Now, first of all, I would like to know, because I've seen a number of photos of Mr. Hayek, and I would really like to know how many facial expressions did he really have? Did he only have those two, or did he have a broader... And also, last year I was here, I heard a person in a panel discussion make a very hard case basically for the right to discriminate. Basically, many libertarians hold forth it's somehow morally acceptable to be intolerant, discriminatory, and excluding of people you for some reason dislike, skin color, creed, or sexual orientation. From the personal perspective of these philosophers, and especially Friedman and Hayek, how would you respond to that argument that it is morally acceptable or morally correct to essentially be an unpleasant person? Thank you very much.
Well, the one about the facial expressions is a hard one. I can only say that I think actually Hayek's face was quite expressive. And I can tell you my feeling when I first met him in the airport in Reykjavik. What I saw walking to me was a tall, aristocratic person that exuded the aura of the old Habsburg Empire. He actually used to joke himself about his nobility being authentic because his family was ennobled before the French Revolution. And families that were ennobled after the French Revolution didn't count really as nobles. That was the joke. And he was extremely polite. He was a gentleman of the old world. He had, you could see actually from the photograph from the Ritz Hotel that there he was smiling and so on, but he was usually serious. And a lot of his students at Chicago in the 1950s, they told me that Hayek for them was distant and serious. he was not at all like that with me or my friends. But I think one reason for that was that he was so extremely delighted in his old age, having been ostracized and in oblivion and being an outsider for quite a while, that young people were discussing and taking seriously his ideas. One story that he sometimes told us and obviously made a strong impression on him was that he was attending the American Economic Association meeting, I think in 1949, and there he was congratulating a young scholar on a recent book of his, The Young Scholars. And then he heard, after he had moved away from him, that the colleagues and friends of the young scholar, they said to him, "You just got the kiss of death." That is to say, when Hayek was congratulating him. Now, to go to the second one, I think that obviously we all have a right to have ideas and even prejudices, but we do not have a right to express them in such a way that they may hurt the feelings of other people. And actually, I think that all three of them would be that kind of persons who wouldn't have done that. And all three of them had prejudices. And Hayek, for example, had actually strong prejudices, but he kept them to himself, personally, and took the correct position that you ought always to behave to other people in a polite way. And one thing that he said over and over again to us, don't ascribe to your opponents base motives. Always regard them as people who are misguided because they have committed intellectual errors or believe in means to ends that are not practicable. So that was basically what he taught us. But all of those three men were gentlemen, although I think that perhaps Hayek was obviously the most of a gentleman and much more so than the two others.
Hey, my name is Sven from Germany. Great talk. Thanks for the many insights. I have one short question because there's sometimes a bit ambiguity about the relationship of Hayek and Mises. Do you have, like, especially during his late years, what was Hayek's opinion on Mises, also on a personal level? Maybe you have, like, a few insights on that. Thanks.
Yes, that's an interesting question. Some of you may know, of course, Mises was a great man and he was a hero. And he was one of the founding members of the Montpellier Society. But that Hayek and Friedman and he had founded in 1947. But at one of the early meetings of the Montpellier Society, people were discussing even just the possibility of redistribution of income. And Mises became enraged, stood up, stormed out, and said in the doors, "You are all a bunch of socialists," to Hayek, Friedman, George Stigler, and others. To return to your question, Hayek was an extremely polite man who could maintain friendly relationships with everybody, including Mises, who was somewhat difficult as a person. Mises fell out, for example, with some of his old disciples. Fritz Makhlup, I think Fritz Makhlup committed the great sin of not supporting the gold standard for a while. So Mises didn't speak to him for years, but the relationship between Mises and Hayek was always cordial. But they were not at all agreeing on things. And Hayek said, and I believe he may have said it to me, some things he may have just read, but he didn't really criticize Mises at any time. But he said that Mises was a rationalist. Mises was a utilitarian. Whereas Hayek himself wasn't really a rationalist because he thought that people often, and some libertarians, they overestimated the ability of individual reason to recreate the world. This was a very Hayekian theme, that each of us has very little knowledge. We are all ignorant, and the only way for us to create a great civilization is by utilizing the knowledge of one another. And this was much more of a Hayekian approach than a Misesian one. So Hayek was also somebody who maintained good relationships with the Chicago School, and it was he who held together, for example, the Montpellier Society, because he was such a gentleman.
Well, thank you very much for that lecture.
GigaT, crowdfunding for you and me.